Welcome to everybody, and you're here on purpose. God has a purpose for your life. Amen. Praise God. Lord, let's just stand this morning, and we're going to open in prayer, and then we're going to sing our first song. Father, thank you today. Lord, we worship you. We lift up the name of Jesus. Come on. The name of Jesus is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are safe. Lord, we're safe in you because of the blood of Jesus has cleansed us. Lord, it's not any good in ourselves that we have done. But Lord, it's because of your mercy. Come on. Thank you for your mercy, Lord, today, and your grace and your goodness that fills us, that helps us today. In Jesus' name. Come on, turn to somebody and give them a high five and tell them, yes. Yes, go ahead. Hallelujah. Amen. Come on, give God the highest praise today. Amen. The highest praise. Hallelujah. Come on, say it, church. Hallelujah. Yes. Okay, we're gonna start again. Okay, all right, we're going now. Okay, come on. Try that. Okay, here we go. All right.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
God. We thank you for who you are, God. Amen. Hallelujah to the Lord Almighty who reigns. Come on up, Pastor Mike, this morning. Oh, yeah. Well, we can sing it again, but.
Ha, ha, ha. If you're happy and you know it, say something. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. This is the house that that love built. You know what I'm saying? This is not, we're here today to just love on each other. Let God know that your neighbor is special to you today. Just look at your neighbor today and think, tell them, say, you're special. You were created for a special reason. You were created on purpose, with a purpose, and God has a plan for your life. Amen. You know, I tried everything else out there, and you know, the only thing I found that satisfies is the Lord Himself. Amen. So here we are today. Through our messes and mistakes and everything else, God is still somehow going to get glory out of it. Amen. I'm just trying to do triple duty today, trying to get the message on the machine back there. And you know, I get so caught up in the Word when I'm getting prepared for the morning messages that I don't give myself enough time to come out here and be ready sometimes. But you know what? Take a deep breath. Amen. Just take a deep breath. Breathe. Don't forget to breathe. Somebody said it's very important, you know, in all that you do, don't forget to breathe. Well, you know what? We appreciate you. I appreciate you ladies being here with us today. Praise God. We've been connected with Teen Challenge for several years now. I just noticed last night I was sitting down going through cards of all the visitors that have been through the church over the years, and noticed that it was in 2012 that Pastor Bernie and his wife first visited with us. Sister Carol visited with us, and we got involved in Teen Challenge right after that, and was on staff for a little while with them. So we know what y'all are dealing with, and trust me, we've been down those roads and everything before. So thank God He's able to deliver, set free, heal. You know, God doesn't do anything halfway.
That's right.
Hallelujah. We're the ones that takes time to catch up with. God's got a perfect plan, and we're just trying to figure it all out, you know. None of us are smart enough to know everything that God has for us, but we discover as we go, and we discover as we stay connected to Him. That's the key, is staying connected to Him and getting our eyes off of ourselves. You know, that's the epitome of selfishness, is seeing our own issues and getting caught up in that. You know, none of us are perfect here today, so if you came for a perfect church, you're in the wrong place. Amen. If you come looking for a perfect pastor, you're in the wrong place. Praise God. And you know, if you get around me too much, you'll say, "Well, he's the pastor." But you know what? Hey, God's got a plan, and He's doing some great things. You can be seated this morning. Praise God. I just want to say, as the Apostle Paul said, he said, "Follow me as I follow Christ." If you can do that, then when you see me getting away from the things of God, then don't follow me if I'm going against, you know, don't follow me if I'm not doing what's in it's in the Word. You see, there's some things that we're figuring out, and there's some things that are written for our edification, exhortation, and comfort, right? So there are some things that we know for sure, and if you see me getting off, hey, say something to me. Pray for me. Praise God. Don't pray on me. Hey, praise God. There's enough people being prayed on out there. We need to pray for one another, huh? So thank God for you all here today. The Zacharys, they're off visiting with family today, celebrating a birthday, and Mom, she's still recuperating. She was. You know, she was up to 110% until we went through Ollie's, Sam's, and Cole's. And then she was like, you know what, my foot's hurting. She'd spent 2 weeks in rehab you know, got to feeling great and doing well. But then she overdid it. Isn't that something, how, you know, we get to feeling like we can do something, and then we overdo it, thinking, you know, we got our mind right. We know, hey, you know, I'm feeling good. I'm feeling spry. You know, and next thing you know, we overdo it, and we're hurting ourselves. So, you know, pray for Mom today. She needs your prayers and encouragement. But boy, is there anything else? I do want to let you know. I do have some letters that we're sending out to the kids that are with us. on Wednesday nights. We got a good group of kids that come out on Wednesdays. And for the summer months, we're going to be doing something a little different. We've got Wednesday nights where we're going to have some game nights, movie nights. We're going to go to see a couple of baseball games coming up this week and next week on Wednesday nights. You know, there's nothing sacred about Wednesday night. You know, I'm just saying, you know, we don't have to always meet right here. We can go out and actually be the church for others to see. Okay, so while we're out doing the ball game thing, we're going to be Jesus out there. We're not going to get out there and act like a bunch of fools, okay? You can be a fool for Christ, and that's okay, but being foolish and doing silly things out there in public, we're out there to be an example. So we're going to take the church to the ball field on Wednesday night. Hoorah, somebody said. So, yeah, that's right. So, you know, we pray for us. Pray for us as we take these kids out. Oh, help us, Jesus. So, and we also have something coming up. I'm not trying to take Brian's thunder here from doing the announcements, but since I did put the letter together here, I want to hit a couple of points on the letter. We're going to do a talent showcase and back-to-school bash. We haven't decided yet if we're going to combine the two, but what it is we want to look for some local talent that – you know, whether you dance, you know, hip hop, you know, whatever it is you do, do it for Jesus. Amen. You know what I'm saying? So if you do it for the Lord, he's going to get glory and people are going to get blessed. So and it's not a talent show. OK, I like what as we had our meeting on Wednesday night, Miss Georgiana said we ought to do a talent showcase, which basically you just show up with your case of show and we go on. Amen. So, yeah, they're right there like that, like that. So, you know, I think it'd be a good idea if we did a back-to-school bash and had the bouncy house like we've done in the past and do it down at the community center. Anyway, there's a letter here. Matter of fact, for the folks over at the Teen Challenge, we could give them a letter as well. And when you see us out, you know, just pray for us. Because, you know, the kids, they can be fun. Yeah, kids can be fun. And when you get two of them together, you got a handful of fun. And you get a whole bunch of them together, you got a trailer load of fun. So praise God. Ha, ha, ha. So anyway, just be aware, you know, that we are going to be doing some things different on Wednesday night. So if you show up here and we're not here, you missed it. you missed the bus. So don't show up late because we ain't leaving late, okay? All right? You get here late, you be left behind. You remember that movie, Left Behind? You don't want to be left behind. Yeah, we're going to have fun. You won't be left behind on the fun. So anyway, I'm going to pass the mic on to Brother Brian. And today is, oh, yes, today. No, tomorrow is. Tomorrow is Brian and Georgiana's 24th anniversary. Today? 23rd. So anyway, the math works out like this. Take tomorrow, subtract one, and today, and then add 23, and you're there. Computations. I'm going to get my tree back up here again from Wednesday. Yeah, we had a talking tree on Wednesday night. Praise God for that. Yes, and Miss Leah, well, she did an awesome job last night. Praise God. Can you stand up, Miss Leah? Woohoo! Go ahead. It's all right. It's all right. It's all right. She's over there. She did an awesome job last night with her dance and tap over at the Distinguished Young Woman deal over there. So, yeah, there's a – you man, I think that was rigged. I'm telling you now. That's all I got to say about that. I think it was rigged. No, man, they had like two people that got all these awards and everything. And I was like, y'all ain't seeing what I see. I mean, she should have got all the awards. I don't know what the story is on that. But anyway, praise God. She got her third runner up. Praise God for winning the $250 for scholarship. Woohoo! Glory to God. Following the, I don't want to say following the steps, footsteps of her sister, but her sister did the same thing. Was it last year? The year before? 2 years ago? Yeah, yeah, her sister did that. Yeah, so toward her, Yeah, right, one book. So anyway, I'm really proud of her. Plus, in addition, since we're on the Harley family here, this is actually their 12th year anniversary with us. So praise God for that. So 12th year anniversary with us, their 20-something, 23rd anniversary. You know, daughter, you know, both their daughters doing well. Son's coming up. He's, you know, tech man extraordinaire back there. I'm going to teach him how to make a lot of money so he can take care of me later. You know, don't worry about mom and dad. Take care of pastor here, right? So anyway, I better shut up before I get in trouble. Okay. Yes, sir.
I have something I need to self-check.
Okay. Got a praise report?
Big praise report.
All right. Well. Rock on.
I've been here about 13 years. When I first started coming here, I was an alcoholic and a smoker.
Woo! Ha, ha, ha.
Working with Pastor Mike, working with Pastor Donald, my brothers and sisters, they prayed for me. Whoever was praying for me, they were praying.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, we had a whole bunch of praying for you.
Alcohol gone, long time ago. Cigarette gone, long time ago. We'll make this short.
Praise God.
Pastor Mike said,
the wealth of the wicked?
The wealth of the wicked.
It's laid up for the righteous.
Laid up for the righteous, right?
Yeah. And the blessing of the Lord maketh rich, and he adds no sorrow with it.
Guess what happened?
Well, you got some wealth, I guess.
A whole lot of wealth.
Woo! Wow.
I had an uncle that I haven't seen since I was 13 years old.
Okay.
He left me enough money. Okay? Every single bill that I got, I could turn to zero.
Praise God.
Yeah.
That's not just it. That ain't just
praise
it.
Praise God.
I can get me a car now.
Glory to God.
Hey.
Yeah, come on.
And the way things are going, I'd be able to keep up that car.
Praise God.
All those other bills, bye bye.
Praise God.
All those other bills, bye bye.
Amen. Amen. Woo.
When he bless you, I find out when you trust.
Amen.
I really trust. I'm not gonna say I trust all the time. I'm gonna say that I didn't file up all the time, because sometimes I really did.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna say I said the right thing all the time, but my faith was in the Lord.
Amen.
And when he blesses you like that,
praise God.
It's
somebody you hadn't seen since you was 13, huh?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden.
All of a sudden.
You know, that's one of those, this is what the Lord reminds me of right now. A faithful man shall abound with blessing.
That's
Proverbs.
That's it.
Hallelujah. So, you know, a faithful, it doesn't mean that it's going to happen today, it's going to happen tomorrow, but it's going to happen. You know, a faithful man will abound with blessing. And Brother Kenny, he's been faithful these 13 years. I mean, he was a knucklehead for a while, but who wasn't, you know? Yeah, you know. I mean, we was all knuckleheads, you know, for a period of time in our walk. Even in our walk with God, we did a case of stupid once in a while. But you know what? You know, we didn't judge him.
No.
You know, there was times he would come in. We know he'd been drinking, but he'd be sitting back here at the sound booth running sound.
Really?
We knew he had been doing stuff. He couldn't hide it, but boy, he thought he could. That breath freshener worked pretty good for a while. But we knew what was going on. But you know what? He finally decided, you know what? I want God more than I want that drink. Well, God delivered him from that drink. A year later, he came back and he testified about what God had did. And then he said, you know what? God, I don't even want that smoking in my life anymore. Well, you know what? God delivered him from the smoking. A year later, he came back because he said this. He said, I don't want to say that God did something and me to fall back on it later. He said, I'm going to give it a year. And you know what? He did what he said he was going to do, and he's been doing what what he said he was going to do. He's remained faithful. So you know what, guys? Whatever our situation is, this is the testimony for all of us. Because I tell you what, there are times I feel like, man, God, where are you? You know? Man, I've been faithful, you know, with this. And you get that little pity party going and, you know, get you, stomp your little foot, act like you somebody. And God just say, you ain't what you think you are, you know? He'll get. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, he says you're a child of God, brother. Amen. Come on now. Thank you for sharing that, brother, man. I tell you what, that ought to just light somebody's fire this morning. Look what God can do. Hadn't seen this person since he was 13. Now, what's the odds of that? That all of a sudden, Uncle David, would leave him enough money that he could be debt-free and get him a car. He'd been saying all these years, there ain't no sense in me getting no car, man, I can't keep it up. I said, brother, we need to change that conversation. Because God can do in 1 minute what it takes you a lifetime to do. Amen? I mean, you know, you either believe that or you don't. But, you know, look around you, you know. I mean, look at what God is doing in all of us. And, you know, this ain't even the message. This is all free. We haven't even taken up the offering yet. But, you know, if you want to get in on this, you can today, all right? you know, I'm just too blessed to be stressed. Praise God. Well, I'm going to have Brother Brian come up here and share what he knows about what's going on around here. And then give Georgiana a chance to give you an opportunity to be blessed. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. I tell you what, Lord is good, and I'm glad that y'all are with us today, and glad Gretchen and Casey and Angela, glad y'all are visiting with us today and a part of our community. We welcome you here as a part of the community as well, and on top of the icing there on Kenny's... you know, it goes back to Sunday school. We have Sunday school at 10 o'clock on Sundays, and what are we learning about? How to live an extraordinary life. And, we've been digging deep. This last chapter was like, ooh, ouch. Oh, ouch. And Holy Spirit's like, okay, let me tell you how it is. Yeah. But like I was sharing with Pastor Don this morning, when the truth is revealed on your innermost part of who you are, you know, it's not there for condemnation. It's there to grow on. The Holy Spirit reveals those things so that you can grow and mature, so that when you go out and reflect Jesus, you're reflecting the best image of Jesus. And so, you know, I appreciate all the kind words, you know, of my children who have blessed me dearly. You know, I seen a little bit of hell growing up as a child that a child should never see. And praise God, that's behind us, and things have been forgiven, and my family's been reconciled. And but you know, it's not of my own that my children have turned out to bless me. It's because I realize that if you do things the way God plans for it, and they're obedient to God as well, then He will bless them. And so that's been just a blessing on my heart to see how they've turned out. And how God is continuing to work with them and use them. And also, my lovely niece, Jordan, she's with us today visiting all the way from Louisville. And so glad you're here today. Put her on the spot. Remember, on Sundays, we meet here for worship at 11 o'clock. Tuesday is our corporate prayer time. If you have prayer requests, please let us know, because we always want to add those to our list. Also in the back, there's a little table there. You got some sticky notes. You can write your prayer request on that, stick it to the wall, and we always continue to pray for those as remembering those in our community and your friends and family. Wednesdays is our midweek service, and Pastor Mike told you the good things coming up for Victory Kids. We have a lot of children that we pick up. They don't always get here on Sunday, but we pick them up on Wednesdays, and they're pretty good about being here, and we have a good outreach with them, and they bless our hearts. Yeah, they're challenged sometimes, but, you know, everything's not meant to be easy, so we just keep on going. And so a lot of good things going on here. The Lord has blessed us greatly for the 12 years we've been here, 13 altogether. We just continue to want to bless our community and love on people. And so with that being said, Georgiana, would you come and share with us our tithes and offerings, please?
So last week we were talking about that Jesus was not poor. So today we're going to continue that with the early New Testament saints were not poor. Okay, this is all leading up to our tithes. Luke was a doctor, and nowhere are doctors numbered with the poor. Even back then, they had money. Matthew was a tax collector, and they were notoriously well off in those days. Of course, sometimes it's because they were not always truthful. You know, Matthew probably was, he was, yeah. James and John had hired servants. In Mark 1, 19 and 20, it says, Jesus saw James the son of Zebedee and John his brother mending their nets. And straightway he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants. So if they had hired servants, they had to have money in order to pay the servants with. Joseph of Arimathea was rich. He's the one that gave up his tomb for Jesus to be buried in. But Matthew 27:57 says, there came a rich man of Arimathea named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciple. God is not a respecter of persons. He does not mind if you prosper. He wants us to prosper. Acts 10:34 says, of a truth I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. So you can also be abundantly blessed by faithfully obeying God with your finances. So we have an offering confession that we say. he's getting it. There we go. Okay. As I pay my tithes and sow my offerings, Lord, you promised to open the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing that I would not have room enough to contain. I'm a kingdom builder so that others may live. I'm a faithful tither and a joyful giver. I sow generously, therefore I reap generously. I am blessed to be a blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Blessed to be a blessing. Is that you? Come on, is that you, church? Yes, yes. Blessed to be a blessing. Come on, it's not just for you. Come on, it's for us, for all of us. Go ahead, honey. We'll get it later. It's here. Hallelujah. I'm going to read this scripture as we get ready to worship. Y'all ready to put on your worship? Worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who has what? A beautiful name. Go ahead, Pastor Mike, if you want to pray. Yes. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord, we thank you. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Amen, amen. Miss Leah, come up and read our scripture today, would you? Come on, how many knows that Jesus... It's right here. That Jesus has been given a name, come on, that is above what? Every name that is named. Amen. Go ahead and read it, Miss Leah.
Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. And then Ephesians chapter 1, 19 through 23.
Come on.
And what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all.
All right, amen. Come on, let's stand and give God worship, amen. Thank you for the word of God this morning, Lord. Come on. You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Amen. Say that name, Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love is greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you. The veil torn before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. Heavens are roaring the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival, Lord. You have no equal. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. Say it again. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. Come on, say his name, Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, we just thank you, Jesus. Jesus. Lord, we love you today. We worship you, Jesus. Come on, say his name. Jesus, the name of Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
something about your name.
Come on, sing it, Master.
Master, Savior, Jesus.
Let all heaven
and
earth proclaim. Come on, church. Kings and kingdoms,
they
shall all pass away, but there's something. Sing it again. I know there's something above. I know there's something about your name.
Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Kings,
what's your name?
Kings and kingdoms, they shall all pass away, but there's something about, Lord, we know there's something about God, there's something about your name,
hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we love you this morning. Lord, we love you. Lord, we lift up the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you today. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you. Hallelujah. Let's just love on Jesus today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We magnify your name, O Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, you are good. Lord, you are good. Hallelujah. Just tell him what he means to you this morning. Lord, Lord, you're a good God. You're an awesome Savior.
Yes.
Jesus, oh Lord, thank you. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, you didn't just save us. Hallelujah. You delivered us. You've healed us. Lord, you've called us into this great and lively hope that we have in you. Lord, it doesn't matter what happens in this life. God, we know that the end of the story is fixed for us. We know that the end is fixed on our behalf. So, Lord, this is a fixed fight. We already win.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Lord, there's none like you today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that you saved us. But thank you, Lord, that you're our Lord. You lead us. You guide us by your Spirit, oh God. And Lord, we don't have to fear anything today. We don't have to fear anything today. Because greater is he that's in us today than he that's in the world.
Yes, thank you.
Hallelujah. Let's make that declaration today. Greater is he.
Greater is he.
That is in me than he that is in the world.
He that's in the world.
I will fear no evil.
I will fear no
evil. For the Lord is in me. He is with me.
Yes, he is with me.
He is around me. He is for me. If God is for me,
God is for me,
and you are for me,
you are for me,
what can be against me?
Yes,
who can be against me?
Who can be against me?
Nothing. Hallelujah. You know what? No weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue that rises up against you in judgment shall be condemned in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
No, we've
Jesus.
Not just been,
thank you, Lord.
We've not just been, it's not just a little bit of, you know, a little dabble, do you know, kind
That's
of thing.
Right.
You know what? When you get into this thing and you get into it neck deep, head deep, you just dive all the way in. I like a baptism I saw of Pastor Brian over in Owensboro. He baptized his son, and all you saw was his feet straight up in the air. I'll tell you what, he
woo! That's all under right there.
He was all in and all under. I'll tell you what, he got in so deep he couldn't even hold his feet down. But you know what? That was a humorous thing. But
hallelujah.
You know what? That's the way we need to be, like a little
come
child.
On.
Just dive into this thing. You know, there's a lot of stuff that we don't understand, some things that don't make sense. But, you know, we're just here to trust and obey. Song says, trust and obey. There is no other way to relate to Him but to trust and obey.
Jesus,
and this morning, let's sing that one more time through. I just love this song. It's probably one of my favorite choruses that we sing. But sing that again. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
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 Jesus. There's just something about that name.
You know what? When the world feels like it's caving in on around you, just cry out, Jesus. Jesus.
Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain.
You're so amazing. There's none like you, Lord.
Jesus.
Jesus. This morning, amen. Hallelujah.
Kings
and
kingdoms,
oh,
they shall
all pass away.
Pass away. Oh, but there's something about.
Hallelujah.
Oh, yes, there's something.
Hallelujah.
Holy about.
Yes, Lord. While you're standing, I'm going to read this scripture out of 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 through 16. This is in the Moffat translation. It says, who singles you out, my brother? What do you possess that has not been given to you? And if it was given you, why do you boast as if it had been gained, not given? You Corinthians have your heart's desire already, have you? You have heaven's riches. You have heaven's rich blessing already. You have come into your kingdom without us. I wish indeed you had come into your kingdom so that we could share it with you. For it seems to me that God means us apostles to come in at the very end, like the doomed gladiators in the arena. We are made a spectacle to the world, to angels and to men. We, for Christ's sake, are fools. You in Christ are sensible. We are weak. You are strong. You are honored. We are in disrepute.
Yeah.
To this very hour, we hunger and thirst. We are ill-clad and knocked about. We are waifs. We work hard for our living. When reviled, we bless. When persecuted, we put up with it. When defamed, we try to conciliate. To this hour, we are treated as the scum of the earth, the very refuse of the world. I do not write this to make you feel ashamed, but to instruct you as beloved children of mine. You have thousands to superintend you in Christ, but you have not more than one father or not many fathers. It was I who in Christ Jesus became your father by means of the gospel. Then imitate me, I beg you.
Yes.
Father, this morning, as we open your word and as we dispense what you've put on
yes,
my heart today, God, I pray that we have ears to hear, that we have eyes to see. And Lord, I pray that your word will wash us clean this morning.
Lord, wash us, Lord.
Just wash us clean this morning with your word and your spirit. Washing. Lord, if there's nothing, if there's anything in us that's not like you today, reveal it, bring it to the surface. And Lord, show us. Show us who we are in you. Hold the mirror of your word and yourself up to us and show us who we really are. Lord, we love you today. We want your best in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. You can be seated this morning.
Yes, God.
Praise God. I trust that the Spirit of the Lord ministered to you in a special way today, and that you leave today, as the song says, you don't have to leave here like you came in Jesus' name. Anybody remember that song? We used to sing that song back in the 80s and early 90s. You don't have to leave here like you came in Jesus' name. This morning, it's the word that is received into the heart, confessed with the mouth, that brings change. Amen. You know, we didn't get to where we are today by accident. Can you try to get that up there for me there, sir? Praise God. We don't have a whole lot to show you this morning, but I did like the image. So if you can get it up there, fine. If not, we're still good. You know, we don't get to, yeah, there you go, fathering. You know, next Sunday's Father's Day, but I thought that there was something that we need to talk about leading up to Father's Day that will help us all, because fathering is a necessary thing in the church today. Yet we see little of it. We see little of it. You know, Paul said, you have many teachers among you, but you don't have many fathers. You know, it's one thing to give somebody a platform, and boy, you know, people love a platform. People want to be seen. People want to be heard. People want to have a platform to do something and say something. And if somebody wants this platform, I used to think it like this. If you want this platform, you can have it. Because I didn't call myself into this, and I surely didn't do anything to deserve to be a pastor or to be here. But when God puts a call on you, you either do it or die. That's kind of the place you get to in God. You either do what God has called you to do or you die, or you think you're living and you're dead anyway. That's the problem with a lot of us. We think we're living, but we're really not. So we know what a father is, and next, you know, I don't have to define to you what a father is, but I'm going to tell you this. Someone who participates in the childbearing process. Selah, pause and ponder. Yes, today's not Father's Day, but a dad is a term of endearment that's earned. Dad is a term of endearment that is earned by someone who is a part of a child's life after the child is born. Anybody can be a father. Anybody can be a mother. If you've got all the right parts, you can produce children in some fashion. Okay? So what I want to focus on today is actually fathering. Fathering. And whether you're a male or a female, as my wife has so eloquently put it to me, fathering doesn't necessarily require you to be a male, because fathering in general is mentoring. Mentoring. Okay? However, there's a lot of fathering that has gone on in history. The definition of the word fathering is a man, according to the dictionary, fathering, a man who is a protector and provider. Right. A person who has originated or established something. It can be used as a prototype or early form of something. You know, like the horse cart was the, they'd say, you know, the horse cart was an image or a fathering of the automobile. You can use that word fathering in many ways. Fathering can mean a man who leads a city. But you know what? We got mayors that lead cities now. We've got governors that lead states now. We've got senators. We've got congressmen. We've got women in all aspects of the political process now. But you know what? There's some notable men that I want to mention. And if I ask you today, who is the father of the U.S., what would you say today? Well, who is the father of the United States of America? Who was in the founding? Does anybody know? George Washington. There you go. Yes. I got to lead you a little further. You know, they say you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. Well, if you put a little salt in his oats, he will drink eventually. So have a little salt with your oats this morning. We have try to make your oats a little salty, make it a little more palatable. We have many founding fathers, Washington, Adams, Jefferson, Madison, Hamilton, Franklin, and many more that signed the Declaration of Independence. We all call them fathers or founding fathers of our country. If you talk about the founding of chemistry, you're talking about Antoine Lavoisier. I'm not French, but I think that's right. Of physics, you know, we've got Newton, Galileo, Einstein. Computing, you got Charles Babbage, created the analytical engine in 1837. In marriage ministry, we have a gentleman named Ray Mossholder that I followed for some time and had him speak for us years ago at a church I attended in, me and Pastor Donna were on staff at in Henderson, a wonderful brother. Gas-propelled autos. We got Carl Benz in 1886, the steam car by Amédée Boilly in 1873. We got a three-wheeled contraption that Nicholas Joseph Cugnot in 1769 created, putted around in. A gentleman that pioneered the modern gas engine, Gottlieb Daimler. Daimler. Does that ring a bell with anybody? Daimler? Yeah, it's spelled Daimler, but he may spell it Daimler. Yeah, you're right. Daimler, first mass-produced car, and you'll recognize this gentleman's name, Ransom Olds, in 1901. The development of the assembly line for auto production by Henry Ford. Modern medicine, Hippocrates, and his teacher, Democritus, or Critus, or, you know, you smarter people probably know his name. In the field of electricity, we got William Gilbert, Michael Faraday, Nikolai Tesla. Tesla. This list of inventing fathers and originators is endless. Everything that we use today was invented by somebody. Can anybody tell me who the father of us all is? Well, you're getting spiritual on me, but I'm saying the guy that originally, Adam, yes. If it wasn't for Adam, none of us would be here. Adam and Eve, yeah, we will have words with Adam when we, you know, Eve was deceived, but Adam fell. Adam sinned, right? We all know that. Now, you know, also, if you think about it, in where we are in history, Noah is the father of us all. Because everything was wiped out during the flood, and Noah and his chillens, they started this whole mess all over again. Praise God. It gets better. Never fear. The answer is here. In our Christian faith, we have the 12 apostles. We got Paul, Silas, Timothy. Got a lot of good men that helped with the founding of the church. Today's faith fathers include men like Billy Graham, Billy Sunday, Jerry Falwell, George Pepperdine, which you probably don't know. He is the founder of Pepperdine University. I'm hoping I'm, or Pepperdine. Well, it's spelled, maybe I misspelled that. I think it's Pepperdine, isn't it? It is. Okay, so I made a mistake. Pepperdine. And the Pentecostal resurgence, resurrection, rebirth, and renewal includes men like, you're probably not going to know any of these names, but William Boardman wrote a book called The Higher Christian Life. The Higher Christian Life back in the 1800s. Alexander Boddy, John Alexander Dowie was a Scottish evangelist and faith healer. Henry Drummond, Andrew Murray. Evan Roberts was a leading figure in the Welsh Revival. Albert Benjamin Simpson he's from Canada and started the Christian and Missionary Alliance. William J. Seymour, which most all of us should know who William J. Seymour was. Remember 1906? Give you a little hint. 1906, Benjamin Seymour going once, going twice, going three times. Azusa Street. A African American preacher, full of the Holy Ghost, got the revelation of the Word of God and the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and was actually a Methodist minister. So the resurgence and resurrection, the rebirth, renewal of Pentecost. See, Pentecost during the Dark Ages was lost because a particular church group didn't see any need for it, or didn't see that it was necessary to experience Pentecost. But you know what? I tell you what, if the early church needed Pentecost, we need it today. Amen. Praise God. If anybody needed a resurgence in the power of the Spirit of God moving through the children of God, it's us today. Yes. Praise God. We got men like Kenneth Hagin, Kenneth Copeland, George Pearson's. Probably don't know him if you don't follow that, but George Pearson is a pastor of Eagle Mountain International Church in Fort Worth, Dallas, Texas area. Creflo Dollar, Jesse Duplantis, Oral Roberts, Billy Wilson. Does anybody know Billy Wilson? Yes.
Oh, yeah.
What do you say? Not personally? I can see where that's a way out of an answer. Yes, okay, gotcha. He has done several things, but the last notable was he was empowered. He was on the board and organized the Empowered 21 movement that is a remembrance of Azusa Street. And he is now currently the president of ORU. And we have the distinct pleasure of calling him a Kentucky brother because he is from Owensboro. So here's a young Owensboroite that is moving and shaking and being used of God to do great things around the world. You know, why take a trip down Fatherhood Trail this morning? Everything we use today has a founder. Everything we use today has an inventor. Think about it. The most basic things that we use today have an inventor. The toothbrush. You can look at your neighbor and say, thank you for using one. The toothbrush was invented in 1498 in China by taking the hair from the back of a horse or a hog's neck. 1498, yeah, for a long time people had 1498 in China. The Chinese were not just good with explosives. They also good with the toothbrush. Thank God for the Chinese. Yes, that's right. Praise God for that, huh? Soap making goes back to at least, according to excavations, to 2800 B.C., thank God for that. The first deodorant was called Mum and produced in 1888. Thank God for your neighbor using some Mum this morning. And remember that right guard works under your left arm too. Hans Schwarzkopf invented shampoo in 1927. Thank God for shampoo for those of you that have hair. Those of us that have hair. Hey, as you can see, nothing just showed up in heaven without first going through the mind of a man first. Let me let you all catch up here this morning. Don't want to leave anybody behind. I don't have a wagon behind me to pull you along. All right. Nothing just showed up here on planet Earth without it first going through the mind of a man first from God. Even George Washington Carver took the peanut, an African-American brother, loved the Lord and prayed, and God gave him hundreds and hundreds of things to use the peanut for. You know, that doesn't just happen by accident. There's nobody with a brain that good that can come up with so many things with just a peanut. He gave God credit for it. Huh? Hey, I tell you what. There's and jelly beans too, I think, right? And so it is in the kingdom of God, praise God. Men and women of faith, including you and me today, are blazing and have blazed a trail that has left a mark on this world. We need to believe God for another resurgence, rebirth, and resurrection of Holy Ghost power. Praise God. Ask yourself today and ask God, what's your plan for me? What's your plan for my life? Who would have ever, who's heard of William Boardman? Not many people. But you know what? He wrote something that stimulated people to think. Alexander Boddy, you don't know him, but he stimulated people to think and trust God. John Alexander Dowie, a Scottish evangelist that went about healing the oppressed, doing the work of Jesus, Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good and healing what? Some? All who were oppressed of the devil. Where did the oppression come from according to God's word? The devil. So if you're oppressed this morning, it's not God. And if you don't know the difference between God and the enemy, you need to learn quick. Amen. You need to learn quick, because people will accept something from the devil thinking God put it on them. But no, God is not here to do us harm. He's here to do us good. Amen. Somebody can either shout or I need to go to where the action is this morning. Praise God. You know what? God wants to use you to do the extraordinary. There was nothing special about these men. They just got a vision from God. Oral Roberts went out on a desolate piece of land, and God spoke to him and said, build me a hospital. Build me a hospital. Build me a university. Something that seemed impossible back when it was done. I think it was finished in 64, 65, somewhere in that range. Oral Roberts University was started. And then the City of Faith, where they combined healing from God with doctors and medicine. They combine the two. I believe that God wants you well. So if you're sick, get prayer. And if you're still sick, go to a doctor, for goodness sakes. You know, I'm just saying, you know, if right now you're struggling in your faith with something, just continue to believe God. Because if you take that pill could kill one person, but it could do another person good. Don't take something without thanking God for the good side effects of it. Okay, no, bind up the evil side effects and trust that God is going to use it to do good in your body. I've made a decision years ago after I come off of drugs and alcohol and everything else that I didn't want to put another drug in my body. I didn't care if it was good for me or not. And I said, you know, I just and that's what I tell my doctors all the time. I said, you got something better than that. Had a doctor, a neurologist, put me on Depakote a couple of months ago, and after taking it a few days, I thought, you know what, the benefit of this isn't worth the side effects that come with it. You know, hair loss, weight gain, and liver damage. So I thought, you know, I can either believe God for healing and restoration in my body, or I can take this thing and believe you to not get old, bald, fat, and all that. So, you know, I just decided, you know what? There's a better way somewhere, and I'm going to find it. Well, you know what? Look at how God works, okay? Mom goes in the hospital, and I'm in the emergency room with her, and a neurologist is on staff at the time, and I told him, I said, "You're a neurologist, huh?" He said, "Yes." I said, "You know, this doctor put me on Depakote and Divalprex and this kind of stuff," and I said, "You know what?" I said, I just don't feel good taking that." He said, "Well, I got some good news for you." "Really?" "Divine appointments." He said, "What you need to do is just take 300 units of CoQ10, and he said, "It'll take care of that." I was like, "Well, hey, guess what? What we're doing? We're taking 300 units of CoQ10, and guess what? It's working. Praise God! But you know what? It's not the drug. It's not the enzyme. But you know what? You could have something lacking in your body that you need a little extra of. If you're low on vitamin D, it's going to have an effect on you. If you're low on some issue or enzyme in your body, you may just need a little pick-me-up for that. You get tired in the middle of the day and you know you're sleeping right, take a little B12. It's a natural thing. It's not a drug that's going to hurt you. Praise God. So there's natural means to healthy living. And, you know, ultimately God is the one that gives these people the wisdom and knowledge to do this stuff. You know, these people aren't smart enough to do all this. They're just getting wisdom from God. Amen. So you know what? I believe today. I believe that God is good. John 10:10, the thief comes to do what? Steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, "I've come that you might have and enjoy life." Hallelujah. Does that mean there's not going to come some trials, testings, and temptations along the way? What is that? You know, what is that? Well, you know what? I determined years ago that if an ache or a pain comes on my body, it must be because I need to go pray for somebody. Does that make sense, or am I just out on here on a limb by myself? Don't cut me off. You know, I start having knee pain and all this, and I said, "Okay, no. This ain't, I'm a child of God." That don't belong to me. So I just begin to speak to that thing. You know, leg, you're part of the body of Christ. Where the Spirit of the Lord dwells, there's liberty. Where the Spirit of the, do you believe that? Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. Do you believe that where the Spirit of the Lord is, Lord? See, you know, maybe we got to talk about that for a second. Okay? The scripture says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. But that's not exactly the full story. The full story is where the Spirit of the Lord is Lord, there is freedom, there is liberty. So just because the Lord may be somewhere doesn't mean that you're going to experience that freedom, because he may not be Lord. He may be Savior. Huh? He may be Savior. But you got to make him Lord. He's got to have your, you got to bend your ear to him. You got to listen for him. He's not just going to do something because he's a sugar daddy. No, we do talk pretty straight here. Do talk pretty straight, sometimes too much. But the point is, he's not a genie in a lamp. Poof, you get three wishes. No, it ain't that. See, he's a Savior. He's got a life preserver there for you. But when he pulls you aboard, he wants to have your attention. He wants to have your life. You know, it's not a matter of saying a little prayer and then, you know, a little baptism, a little oil on your head. You know, we pray for some people till their hair fall out and they still don't get some. But you know what the deal is? If you know, we believe God, but you got to believe God too. You got to believe God too. Amen. Well, that's getting deep now. Whew. Wow. Deep sheep. Oh, Lord, help us dig out of this hole. All right. Hey, do you love Jesus this morning? Do you love me this morning? All right. I didn't get 100% on that. Let me try. You know what? yeah, right, would. Would, he says. I'll tell you what. How do you want to be remembered? All these men I named today were simple men. They were all born the same way you and I were, came through the same avenue that you and I did. Yet some had a passion for something specific. What the problem is for some of us is we're passionate about everything and we don't know nothing. I mean, can you follow that line of thinking? Well, we want to do everything. Well, I want to be a this, and I want to be a that, and I want to dabble in this. See, that's been my problem for a long time, is I can be a jack of all trades but a master of none of them. Ouch. Hallelujah. Yes, ma'am. Well, it's fathering. We're talking about fathers and leading up to Father's Day. If you was here on Mother's Day, you got a whole lot of mothers in on this. Okay. See that you sound like my wife now. She's like, yeah, you gotta get them women in there. I said, well, you got your due. It was last month. So just sit and listen. No. How do you want to be remembered? If we was to put your epitaph up on the screen today, what do you want your legacy to be? What do you want to be known by when you're not here anymore? Well, you know, I lived in Dixon and yeah. I lived in Providence, you know, I lived, you know. Well, you know what? Do you want to be known as busy? Educated. Oh, yeah, they're so smart, they're stupid. You want to be educated, financially prosperous, strong-willed. Oh, yeah, he was strong-willed, boy. He set his mind to something. You ain't going to change him. Maybe you've invented some gadget or discovered the cure for cancer or other diseases. Maybe you've led men into battle and sacrificed your life for the sake of freedom. Or maybe it was a conscientious cooperator like Desmond Doss. The Army wanted to label him a conscientious objector, but he said, no, I'm not objecting. I'm just not going to carry a weapon. He said, I'm not joining the military to take life. I'm joining to save life. And you know what Mr. Desmond did? We saw the movie the other day. You can catch the filtered version on YouTube through a commentary or a documentary, rather. It's much more palatable. Yes, because that movie is very graphic, Hacksaw Ridge. But you know what? His drill sergeant saw him, and he said, you know, he called him what, beanpole or something like that. He called him something. You know, he said, man, don't get in front of a strong wind. They'll blow you over. Yeah. Well, you know what? This young man carried 75 men from the battlefield to save their lives. Hacksaw Ridge is like a 75-foot cliff going into the battle. That's right. But every time he would take a man to the cliff and lower him down, he would just sit there. He'd say, God, give me another one. God, give me another one. God, give me another one. To the point his hands were bleeding and raw. God, give me another one. God, give me another one. And when he come down off the cliff after the last one that he could save, can you imagine the shell shock that he was in? Here people come up to him and they're trying to give him a pat on the back and say, thank you for what you did. And he's like, what's going on here? You know, the men would not go back up that hill again, would not go back up that cliff again until he was ready to go. And you know what? This is how much respect the man got after proving himself faithful, even without a weapon. It was Saturday. And it was time to go up and fight again. He told them, and his captain, his company commander came to him. He says, now, I know that this is your Sabbath. But he said, you know, we're required to go up the hill. And basically with or without you. But he said, you know what? The men aren't going back up that cliff unless you go. Can you imagine that? The men are not going back up. This battalion, this group is not going back up. They will not go back up without you. And Desmond said, and he said, I need to pray. And here they are calling in strikes into the land. And the battalion commander's like, what are you doing? How come you're not going up? And the company commander said, Desmond is not ready to go yet. Private Doss is not ready to go yet. Who is this? Who is this that's stopping the war? He says, as soon as he's ready, we'll go. They go back up, and the rest of the story is that, you know, he did get shot, but he lived through it, and he lived to be able to tell the story with the others that said, I didn't want this man with me, because if he wasn't going to carry a weapon, he wasn't going with me. But he ended up being the one that saved more, did more for that exercise, for what they did, than any other man. So, guys, this is the thing. What do you want to be known by when you're gone? Maybe you'll be remembered as sensitive, merciful, and compassionate. Maybe you were a defender of the weak, supportive. Maybe you're a mentor. Jesus' mission is this, to restore mankind to relationship with God and build the church. Be honest with yourself this morning as I close. Be honest with yourself. Are you willing to be a tool in God's hand? That's what Mother Teresa became famous for. She said, I'm just a pencil in the hand of God. God is writing my story. I'm just following Him.
Yeah.
I'm just following Him. Just following my heart. Are you willing to let Holy Spirit use you to father this generation and the next to come? Acts 13:36. I'm going to close with this. David, after having been useful to his own generation in accordance with God's purpose, did fall asleep. He died. Listen to that. David, after having been useful. Are we useful?
Jesus.
To his own generation in accordance with God's purpose. Then he fell asleep. Search your heart this morning. What do you want? As a pastor, what do you want me to speak over you? Your funeral, if I get the displeasure to do such a thing. Yeah, exactly. There you go. I've done a lot of funerals with the military and the that's got to be some of the saddest funerals, to realize that young men, 18, 19, 20, 30, dying in service to their country. I got to where I just couldn't do it anymore. I just had to, you know, say, I've had enough of this. And the first funeral I do here is for a baby. You know, some people, the best I can say at a funeral is if they were here right now, they would say, get right with God.
Yeah.
Seriously, because I have no idea if they're going to heaven or hell. I mean, don't expect me to judge you into heaven if I can't judge you out of hell. Do you follow what I'm saying? Don't expect me to judge you into heaven if you can't listen to me when I'm trying to help you get to heaven. So the best thing we can do, say at some funerals, is right now, if they were here, they would say, get right with God. Live for Him. If only I had a second chance. If only I had another chance. Well, here's your chance.
Jesus.
I don't know. Like I said, I'm not judging anybody into heaven or into hell. All I'm saying is will you choose to follow Him more closely today? If you know Him, will you choose to serve Him with all your heart? Will you mine out? Will you search the Scriptures? Will you live for Him and trust Him?
Come on.
We've got testimonies of God's faithfulness all over the room. We all have a testimony of God's faithfulness.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Healing. Stand with me this morning as we close.
There's healing in your presence.
What do you want your epitaph to be? What do you want us to put on that tombstone? What do you want us to put on there?
Jesus.
Love God, love people.
Who?
Or I wish I had a second chance. With your heads bowed, eyes closed this morning, nothing magical about this part of the service other than to give you an opportunity to close yourself in with God and say, Lord, help.
Yes, Lord, help me.
Help me today. I need you. We just, right there, just between you and the Lord. Lord, I need you. And you know, the more I live for the Lord, I'm able to say now, Lord, I want you.
Yeah.
Well, we start out with this thing, Lord, I need you. I need you. I need you.
Yes, Lord.
But you know, as we spend time in His presence, we realize, man, Lord, I want you. I want you. I'm not giving anything up. I'm only giving it over to you so that you can give me something better. And if that's your prayer this morning, just slip up your hand real quick. I'm just,
yes,
with your heads bowed and eyes closed, I just want you to slip up your hand real quick and just say, Lord, I want you. I want you. Yes, see those hands. Praise God. Yes, I want you. Lord, I want you.
Yes.
Lord, I want you. Let's make that declaration. Lord, I want you.
I want you.
Lord, I need you, but God, I want you. I want you to, I needed you to become Savior, but Lord, I want you to be Lord. I needed you to save me from myself, but Lord, now I want you to help me to become like you. Lord, I want you. I want to be like you. Lord, I'm tired of being me. I'm tired of being like me.
Yeah,
Lord, I'm tired of being, you know, people may have accused you, said, oh, you're gonna be like your aunt this or your uncle that or your dad. You're gonna be just like them. Well, they've labeled you, they put you in prison and you weren't even there yet. They said you weren't gonna amount to anything, but But you did, and you can, and maybe you fell into some of those prophecies that people spoke over you, but now you're saying, no, no, that's not me. I see myself in the reflection of God's word, and God's word says, I'm a child of God. I'm above only and not beneath. I'm the head and not the tail. Yes. I'm blessed coming in, blessed going out. I'm above only, and I'm blessed. So Lord, this morning today, I remove the labels. I take the labels off of people's lives, and God has set us free. Free to be who you've created us to be. Lord, there's ideas, there's inventions, there's creations, there's things to be accomplished in this life that only some of us can do in here. So Lord, I pray that you'll put a holy fervor, a holy passion in us to do the thing that you put in us. God, help us to see our need for you, but also to see our want for you.
Yes, Lord.
Jesus.
Do it, God.
Jesus. Jesus.
Yes.
Jesus. Lord, be magnified in this place today. Jesus. He sees your brokenness this morning. He sees your brokenness today, and he says, I want to put the pieces back together. If you would like for us to pray for you this morning, come on up and allow us just to pray with you. We believe in the laying on of hands. We believe in anointing with oil. We believe in praying over folks. So if we can pray with you and agree with you for this process of transformation to be expedited. You know, there is a such thing as expedited increase. There's exponential increase. We can either slug along, or we can be like that racehorse, unbridled, yet bridled by the Spirit of God, unbridled by men's attitudes and thoughts over us, but bridled by the Spirit of God.
Yes, Lord.
So we want to pray with you this morning, if you would like for us to. But just know this morning, God's got better. God's got some good things in store this morning. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. 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 Pastor Don, I want you to come down and help us pray. Would you put on something back there for us to, you know, worship with while we're praying this morning? Praise God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes, Holy God.
Come on down here, Pastor Don. Help us pray. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just lift our hands all over the room this morning. Praise God. There's more that should be down here too this morning, but you know what? We're just going to pray this morning, and we're going to agree what the devil meant for evil, God is turning around for the good. Hallelujah. What Satan has stolen, it's going to be returned sevenfold in the name of Jesus. So, Lord, I thank you right now. Thank you right now. Yes. Yes, Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, as we stand before you worshiping today. Oh, God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, freedom. 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 Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Come around here, Pastor Donna. I want you to pray with her specifically here. Praise God. In the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. Freedom. Freedom. Hallelujah. You know, whom the child of God has set free is free indeed. So, Lord, this morning, we're believing. Believe in you. Yeah. 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 Hallelujah. Oh, yes. Yes, right now, Lord. You hear the cry of her heart. Yes. Help her, Lord. Yeah, that's it. That's it. Hallelujah. Yes, she's taken this step of faith this morning. Now, Lord, I thank you that you meet her right where she is, God. Yes, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for deliverance. Thank you, Lord, for deliverance. Lord, never look. We're not going to look back, Lord. We're not looking back. We're moving forward. We're moving forward. Yeah, hallelujah. I want you to make this declaration now. I'm going forward. I'm moving forward. I'm moving forward. You know, when the devil reminds you of your past, you know, you just remind him of how big your God is. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you just remind him how big your God is. Lord, ha, 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 ha. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Freedom, 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 freedom in Jesus' name.
Yeah, yeah. Just make it. I'm free. No longer entangled. No longer entangled with those things that have me bound. Hallelujah. Freedom. Boy, I just pray right now to remove people that need to be removed from her walk, and put people in her walk that is going to help develop and grow her walk. Thank you, Father. Lord, you see the hunger in her heart this morning. So, Lord, we just pray right now that you just stir it up. Stir up the hunger this morning. Stir up the hunger for more of you. Lord, it's about you this morning. Lord, it's about you this morning. Lord, we want to stand before you. She wants to stand before you and hear you say, enter in, thou good and faithful servant. So, Lord, thank you for that. Lord, we're believing for that this morning. You just worship the Lord right there. Praise God. Hallelujah. How can we agree with you? How can we pray with you this morning? Okay. Well, Father, you see this mother's heart this morning. We bind the devil, we bind you right now in the name of Jesus. You have no authority. What's his name?
David.
You have no authority over David. As his mother is standing in faith right now, Lord, we are believing you for you know, the scriptures, that some things come out of prayer and fasting, and some things just come out as we get the wisdom of God, as we pray in the Spirit. He's going to give you the wisdom as you pray in the Spirit. You're Spirit-filled, aren't you? Yes, you are. I just say this is by the Spirit of the Lord. Just pray in the Spirit, and as things come to your understanding, then you begin to declare those things over him, because the devil wants us to focus upon the problem, and God's going to give you the solution as you pray this out in the Spirit. Just keep, yes. Lord, we just stir up. Lord, we stir up, Lord, the anointing this morning. Hallelujah. Stir up the anointing this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Play something back there for me, son. Pray it out. You know what? We need to pray till we break through. Pray till we break through. Hallelujah. So, Lord, we're just praying through this, Lord, until you get the release. It's how long does it take to pray to get the breakthrough? Yeah, that's right. But he's a liar. Devil, you're a liar. And they tell you to back off in Jesus' name. Now, Lord, we just believe you and pray for a Lord, just exponential increase. Lord, first, you said in 3 John 2, you said, beloved, I would that you prosper and be in health as your soul prospers. So, Lord, I thank you for soul prosperity. I thank you, Lord, that as her soul has already been prospering, the devil's just trying to deceive her, Lord. So, Lord, we tell the devil to back off. You have no authority in this family. You have no authority in David's life. And we pray right now, wherever David is, that, Lord, you speak to him. That, Lord, as he opens up the Word of God, that, Lord, it comes alive to him. Lord, send laborers across his path even now to be able to minister to him and to speak words that are going to set him free in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, be magnified. Lord, be magnified. Hallelujah. Now, you know, moms have a special, sons have a special place in their mom's heart. You know, your children are special and precious to you. And that's from God. God gave you that because you're the watchman. You're a watchman over his soul. So you've done your part. And now it's time just to believe God, trust God for his part. And you know, if you need prayer support at any time, just call us anytime. We'll just pray and agree with you, because the devil's trying to steal your joy, and he's trying to steal your joy, but he's not going to do it. He's not going to be successful. Okay, praise God, Lord. Thank you. I pray you stir up my sister's joy this morning. Hallelujah, Lord. Stir up the joy. Stir up the joy, Lord. You said out of her belly would flow rivers of living water. Yes. It's done. Yes, it's done. In Jesus' name, you're not being this isn't something you're being punished for. You've not done something to bring your son into condemnation or anything. You are free. You are free in Jesus' name. God has seen your cry. He has heard. He has seen your tears. He has heard your prayer, and he is working on this. The angels of God are ministering to him even now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Just when you leave here today, expect to hear good news. Expect to hear a good report, because God is working on this. This is on God's heart. You're his mouthpiece to speak the answers for your son. So, Lord, we're gonna stand and declare the promises of God. You promised us household salvation. So, Lord, we declare that David is saved. We call him sanctified. We call him filled with the Holy Ghost. We call him free to be what you called him and created him to be. The enemy has tried to kill, steal, and destroy. But, Lord, it's over. It's over. It's over in Jesus' name. We declare it to be over in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Turn his heart toward you as never before. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 I enjoy being out in the world. I mean, goodness. But you know what? I enjoy being in Christ more.
Yes, I do too. I love being back and forth, back and forth. I don't cry. Then I just don't fall back.
Well, you know what?
Getting into church and stuff like that, that's my problem. I want it, but then I don't. You know what I mean? You know what I'm saying?
Sure, yeah. Well, I fully understand. Okay, and there was a whole room full of people understand the same thing. Okay, praise God. Ha ha ha! Hallelujah. Well, we're going to dismiss this morning. Praise God for Jesus. Amen. You know what? If you don't know what to be thankful for, just thank God for Jesus. You know that song, Jesus, 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 something about that name. You know, I've seen times where I'd be in a pickle and just cry out, Jesus. And you know, a situation turn around just like that. Hey, I tell you what, it even works on toilet bowls too. I was standing there watching. I was standing around watching the water rise, and I said, "Jesus!" You know why that thing just went on? I don't know, but that's my testimony. I tell you what, when you're in a pickle, if Jesus can't help you, you know you need a mop. You know I'm telling you. So praise God. Oh man, well. If you feel better than when you came, say amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, you know, I do. And I'm just glad to know Jesus. Amen. Praise God. And I think we all can say the same thing. You know, I'm just glad I know Jesus. Wow. You know, you can know the wealthiest person in the world, but if you don't know Jesus, you're no better off. Yeah, you don't know diddly squat if you don't know Jesus, right? You know what? Rich people are committing suicide. You know that, right? Yeah. There's no peace in all that. You can have wealth. I'm not saying that God doesn't want you wealthy or healthy or anything else. God wants you wealthy because, you know, that's Deuteronomy tells us that he gives us the power, he gives us the ability to get wealth so that he may establish his covenant. That's the real purpose for wealth for a believer, is that we can build the kingdom and we can see people in other parts of the world come to know Jesus. And even in our own backyard, there's people that need to know Jesus, right? Praise God. So let's close this morning. I'm going to ask Brian, would you mind closing us in prayer this morning? Thank you, Jesus. Jesus. Yes, Lord.